physics department, I'm also the moderator at the City Booth. It's a great honor to be here today, tonight, and to introduce Mark O'Connor. He's taught at Boston College since the 1974-75 academic year, and from 1981 until 2012, he was the director of the Arts and Sciences Honors Program here at Boston College. He was the second winner of the Phi Beta Kappa Teaching Award when BC established that, and the first winner of the Alpha Sigma Nu Teaching Awards, which is the Jesuits Honor Society, when BC established that. He has received grants over the years from various foundations, among them the Ford Foundation, the Exxon Foundation, Nullen, and the Davis Foundation, and IREX. After the fall of communism, Professor O'Connor was asked to participate in the Artes Liberalis movement to revivify liberal education in Eastern Europe, and in 2006 received the Amicus Poloni Award, and the highest honor the Polish government gives to a non-Polish citizen. He collaborated in the establishment of the Collegium Artis Liberalis in the University of Warsaw, a special program of studies for the university's top students, which opened its doors in 2009. His most recent involvement with the Collegium was to help it receive a grant from the Loeb Foundation at Harvard for rethinking the role of classical studies in the modern curriculum. He is on the steering committee of an international Francophone seminar, which concerns itself with the relation of aesthetics to spirituality. And the seminar is based principally in Belgium and in France. The greatest award, however, Professor O'Connor has received is his academic career and the privilege of sharing the seminar table with Boston College undergraduates. Thank you.
Thank you.
I speak this way?
Yes.
Well, when Annika Corey got back to me on behalf of the offices of Alpha Sigma Nu about the venue for this talk, what made her email especially touching was the tone of mild disappointment that none of the sexy Stokes lecture halls were available for this time and this date that I had chosen. So Ali and the other offices of Alpha Sigma Nu must have been more than mildly bemused by how pleased I was to find out that we'd be gathering here in well-worn McGuinn 121. I am thrilled because now at the end of my Boston College teaching career, I get to come back to the room where it began. And even better, I am back with three distinguished BC grads who were with me in this room in the mid-1970s. Joe Benito is currently a senior vice president at Bank of America. He's had many job titles over these past four decades since he started at Procter & Gamble. My favorite comes from when Joe was advisor, and he was called Director of Worldwide Effectiveness. Wowza. And Joe had that even an inkling in 1975. And sporting that year, he'd someday become a leader in teaching business people how to do things the right way. Worldwide, no less. And then look at me. I look at myself in my much, much worse shirt. Me with pen in the pocket, but at least a book in the hand. And the fact that I'm here with you today seems even more miraculous. Nick Burns, too, has been in the business of worldwide effectiveness. Come on, stand up. He's been effective worldwide in a diplomatic career that has taken him to Russia, to the Middle East, to Greece, to Brussels as our ambassador to NATO. Now he's plying worldwide effectiveness to students who come to Harvard from around the globe. But Nick, too, has chosen to take up the teaching tour. He's now a professor of diplomacy at the Kennedy School. And as for Francis Scott Wyman, Scott, you played a particularly crucial role in helping me understand what I had to be a teacher. And then Francis took his exceptional effectiveness across the Atlantic to Oxford University, where he earned an MPhil degree focusing on Soviet-East German relations. Francis, Joe, and Nick have returned regularly to Boston College. In fact, Francis came back to devote 15 years of his life to alma mater in our university's development arm. Nick was just back on campus as the university's featured speaker for Litari Sunday. 15 years ago, he returned here to receive an honorary degree. Joe will be coming up again from New Jersey on Thursday of next week as a core part of the celebration of 50 years of the Jenks Leadership Program. The four of us now share a gone, at the blink of an eye, 40-something years attachment to this room and to this space. Over these years, we've been for one another the sort of good memory Dostoevsky says protects a person from harm. And I bet that when Nick, Francis, and Joe come back to BC, each has had more than once the experience that T.S. Eliot captures eloquently in the next to last portion of the last of his four quartets. We shall not cease from exploration. And the end of all our exploring will be to arrive where we started and know the place for the first time. Maybe they're even feeling a bit of that now, even as I am. Now, as a professor, I've been most swept up in the sensation of returning to where I started and knowing the place for the first time at the beginning of each academic year. Now that you're well established as college students, I bet that's become true for you too. We know the place, maybe right down sometimes to the same seat, but there's always a powerful strangeness to the sameness. So when I was asked a few years back, in a setting similar to this one, to speak to some of you who are here again today in 121, I chose as my theme a line I return to now. It comes from Shakespeare's play, Twelfth Night. And the line goes, "What country, friends, is this?" I chose the question to represent the strange trafficking we all feel when we walk into a classroom. In the second scene of the play, we meet our hero, Viola, just as she's introduced, by shipwreck, no less, to a new place, and she needs to find out just where she is. But there were more reasons than just that. I singled the sentence out just as much for the character Shakespeare creates to ask the question as I did for the question itself. Viola is a real smart, resourceful young woman who, over the course of her playing, will have to hide out in a different gender to navigate her new surroundings. And Viola plays her made-up part as Cesare so successfully. She'll become a loved object in both of her engendered roles. I needed that real smart, resourceful heroine to represent you, Michael. And you, Daniel, and you, Michael, and you, JT, all of you that shared the seminar table with me, who would appear questioning in front of me. On the first day of every term, having landed in my seminar, you walk in wondering what kind of country you will end up exploring and cultivating this time. And thanks to you, it was always just as true for me. Then and now, I use Viola's question to foreground one of my own, the one that seems most appropriate to ask and try to answer together with an audience of Alpha Sigma Nu scholars. What's distinctive about how a Jesuit and Catholic country get cultivated? My own answer, after more than 40 years here and four more as an undergrad at Holy Cross, begins with this premise. I think that whatever your own answer ends up being, it ought not to stop with the technical grounding you're acquiring through your studies. Our university's cutting-edge scholars are supplying that learning to you, and doing it superbly, surely. They're doing it in your chosen majors and minds. My last lecture, last wisdom to each of you young scholars is this: whether you're schooling has been in management or education, the arts or the sciences, and no matter how much your major has helped you master ever more complex topics, that's still just the start of coming to know your place. While fundamental and essential, high competency, even to the point of virtuosity, is not sufficient to cultivate our common country and ourselves. Over this past year, my last, I got to know this conviction again for the first time. And it happened while I was translating from Polish an 18th century book for the Institute of Jesuit Sources. Way back when I met Francis, Nick, and Joe, I was also, through my early scholarly research, making the acquaintance of a certain Father Grzegorz Geremowicz, along with a number of his fellow 18th century Jesuits. And I was meeting them just at the moment when they had taken away from them the privilege of calling themselves Jesuits. As many of you already know, the Society of Jesus was abolished in 1773 by Pope Clement XIV. The Jesuits will not be reconstituted until 1814, and by then, very few were left from the generation that had been subjected to the suppression. Father Geremowicz himself headed off to heaven, as you can see from that, in 1801. Now, the original title of his book, and I promise many of you would do this, is Povinnosti Nauczyciela. That translates to the duties of a teacher. After more than 40 years of professing here at PC, the chance to find out what I should have been doing all along was simply an offer that was too good to resist. Well, in one of the first passages I had to render into suitable English, Father Geremowicz says this. A teacher should should always remind himself that he is not called to do what bad teachers take as their calling. Just teach reading and writing, not care about anything more. Your primary goal, your first obligation as a teacher, is to raise honest, loving persons who will live out the virtues as they carry through their duties. When Father Fedomovich wrote those words in 1787, he was no longer a member of the Society of Jesus, but he was still very much the man who had first learned in Jesuit schools and then taught them. The Ignatian tradition insists that teaching has a higher design, transcending any particular discipline. Profs are supposed to provoke students to examine the new knowledge they've acquired and ask themselves how they've been changed by that knowledge. The cultivating process begins with grounding questions like, how did I learn what I learned? Which concepts have hung around and why? How did I get really good at this? Now, there's a common misconception, and it's dear to professors and students alike, that good teaching is all about making hard study seem engaging without effort. Well, certainly it's partly that. The real smart distinguish themselves by making clear and distinct entryways into what the rest of us find unintelligible. But teaching according to Ignatian precepts must eventually tackle a terrain with a different sort of steepness than the one you encounter when you master complex concepts. And unlike the moment where the student recognizes she's on a foreign shore and she's lost, sometimes he needs to be alerted to what's foreign about familiar terrain, even to his professor. Soon after wondering what the country, Viola follows up by asking, "Knowest thou this country?" We, the highly trained, can answer with what Viola hears back, "Ah, madam, well." And we can get on with our professorial professional play. But at some point, while sharing the lay of our scholarly land, scholars who would also be teachers should, in my estimation, return with you folks, our scholarly students, to self-conscious interrogation. The sort of questioning that can be uneasy, awkward, because it interrupts what is playful in the hard work. Let me give you an example. Mozart's La Ci Darem La Mano. It's the most beautiful duet I know of in any language. The music is incredibly seductive, and that's the whole point. Don Giovanni, our serial seducer, is using it to entice the betrothed peasant girl, Zerlina, away from her husband-to-be, Mancetto. You enjoy the music. The way the separation in Giovanni and Zerlina's voices turns into a beautiful married unity. Sublime. Then, if you're sufficiently trained, you can analyze Mozart's compositional tactics in this operatic masterpiece. But you can also, and in our Jesuit country, you should also, now ask yourself what this masterwork means for the way you understand the relation between the beautiful and the good. When the beautiful serves the bad, is it still good? Or take a look at Jacques-Louis David's masterpiece, The Death of Marat. It's a beautiful lie meant to serve a higher truth, to make us see Marat as David thinks we really should, for the good of the Jacobin cause. Study the history of the French Revolution, and you know that Marat suffered from a wretched, disfiguring, disgusting skin disease. All that scabby skin has been brushed away. But at least David left Marat in his tub where David found him the day before, covered with the same green cloth. Left him in his tub, however, in a Christ replacement, Pieta pose, with the death-dealing knife insertion so precise, you have to conclude that the assassin, Charlotte Corday, was a surgeon in her spare time. Oh, the note in his hand? That's phony, too. Corday didn't get in to see him by leaning on his sympathy.
the serial executioner, but I didn't have it. The note she handed him was a trumped up list of traitors. Marat promised he'd have dead within a week. And hearing that was her signal to kill him instead. David puts all of his considerable talents to work in using his head to guide his skillful hand. He sanctified a very different vision of human purpose and the point of sacrifice. The Christian imagery we see here renders holy Marat's martyrdom to the revolutionary cause in the belief that everything is permitted, from the guillotine, to brushing over history, to bring into being a more materially just world. So then, what is the relation between the beautiful and the good, when bad and beautiful is brought together to bring about the good? And just where does that leave the notion of truth? Searching for where truth lies and doesn't lie. In other words, where the truth is to be found and where its moral interpretation is waiting to be discovered, depends upon what the Jesuits have taught me to call discernment, namely a fuller awareness of the consequences of our actions on ourselves, on others, on the world around us. My predecessor as the director of honors, who is with us today, Father Joseph Appleyard, when asked to define the point of Jesuit education, put it this way. The goal, he said, is to produce men and women for whom discernment is a habit. But to make a habit that works well, you first have to develop the habit of hard work. You have to use your real smart minds to learn the lay of the land. You need to cultivate the place over and over to know it for the first time again and again. Here's another famous masterwork where landscape still keeps shifting. A painting that alerts us to the problem of our perspective by its self-conscious rejection of the rules of composition. Manet's first title for this tableau was The Bath. It foregrounded the what's our perspective problem by drawing our sight to the larger-than-life woman in the background. His second title, Lunching on the Grass, draws us back to the three figures in the foreground. His last title, The Force, brings all these figures, front and back, together in a relationally provocative way. Knowing just this much makes discernment at once more demanding and more difficult. But it makes it more enjoyable too, especially when you know the name of the naked lady who's looking out at you so intently. Then you catch that I've chosen this painting to be able to turn Viola into Victorine. But you get much more intellectual enjoyment to the discerning process when you study the lay of this landscape to learn what it took art critics a generation to discover. The compositional arrangement draws upon a Raphael-inspired engraving. It deals with the classical myth where Paris is choosing whether to award the golden apple to Hera, Athena, or Aphrodite, and receive in exchange either rule from Hera, wisdom and skill from Athena, or a beautiful woman from Aphrodite. Now, those of you who have shared the seminar table with me can see where this is going. You know that in our class, the answer is invariably the sex of Jesus. Since we've already talked about Jesus, it's got to be sex this time. Here, our discernment is brought to bear on our engendered roles. And Victorine's knowing gaze engages ours. I think it especially engages all of us males who play the choosing role of Paris, either as artist or as viewer. And everyone, male and female, gets to ask not just what is the relation between the beautiful and the good, the just what you think constitutes beauty. What is beautiful? And just whom we, and especially the violas and Victorines among us here, whom we think ought to control beauty's definition. Monet employed a compositional strategy that draws upon the long ago and the far away to define his now. He passes through the Renaissance, all the way back to antiquity, to return to the myth about the judgment of Paris as a tactic to challenge the judgment of his Paris in 1863. And we've been exploiting that strategy ever since, right down to the last judgment of Paris before France's current election is made. Have you seen that one? Ultimately, then, it's all about where you choose to place yourself in the picture and how you choose to place yourself in the picture. Since 2005, in this group, it's become a seminar tradition to leave me with a class photo, suitably framed. They sit on my office shelves, they hang on my wall, then more of the memories Dostoevsky says protects us from harm. And as you can see from a few of them, I hope some of you out there have seen yourselves. As you can see from a few of them, each successive class has taken note of where previous seminars have positioned themselves and made sure to choose a place of their own. But last year's group, the class of 2018, after doing the conventional group portrait, oh, there you go, it's coming, chose to do another one. Now, you all need to know that on my final exams, there is always a wisdom question to accompany the more numerous knowledge one. With the wisdom question, there are no right or wrong answers, but there sure are better and worse ones. The wisdom question last year involved this painting. The anticipation for the members of the class that you had is really right for the moment. I hope you're all feeling it. Okay. The Raft of the Medusa by Jean-Louis Théodore Shevchenko. And once again, we are dealing with an actual historical moment. But there really was such a raft made up of the remnants of a ship that was named, you can't make this stuff up, the Medusa. And on that raft were stuffed 150 people, 149 men and one woman. You can't make this stuff up. And they were all left to drift off and die. Jericho depicts the moment when the few remaining survivors sight a ship so far off it's barely visible. Again, we're dealing with a beautiful line. After more than 2 weeks in the scorching sun, somewhere off the African coast, their skin should be every bit as scabby as my own's. And these survivors, who have had to resort to cannibalism in order to survive, shouldn't look like they just stepped out of Gold's Gym. But evidently, last year's folks most saw what I most see, a crossing X of human aspiration built into a human pyramid straining for collective salvation against the superb indifference of the natural forces, wind and wave, that are bringing them ever closer to the engulfing forces and the darkness of the wave you see looming up over them, behind them, moving to seal their fate. So, once they had survived the exam last spring, the seminar gave me this. Oh, isn't that cute? And then they gave me this. at the end of an exceedingly long poem by Wordsworth, most of which has been forgotten. Just, frankly, as so much of his poetry has been. There's a line that's still remembered. Well, at least it's remembered by professors who teach the humanities, like Jonathan Mulrooney, chair of the English Department at Holy Cross, graduate of Boston College Arts and Sciences Honors Program, and James T. Flynn, professor emeritus of history of the College of the Holy Cross, who is the reason I am here with you today. All 4 years, while he was inspiring me at Holy Cross, Professor Flynn wore his Boston College class ring. I noticed. Well, as for the line, these days, whether its sentiment is recollected in irony or as inspiration depends upon the circumstances. Today's circumstances, Dayton, bring the line to my mind out of gratitude. It goes like this. What we have loved, others will love, and we will teach them how. I much appreciate this chance at the conclusion of my career to express gratefulness to the Jesuits of Holy Cross and here at BC for guiding and instructing me well in what to love. For their example and their guidance in directing Boston College's Arts and Sciences Honors Program, I owe debts of gratitude to Father David Gill and to Father Joseph Appelmer. I can never ever repay. But I have tried my best to repay forward to succeeding generations of Honors Program students. For teaching me how to share what I have loved, I thank Professors Thomas Whipple Perry, John L. Heineman, and Samuel J. Miller of the Boston College History Department, each of whom once stood where I stand now. The academic gown you see me in is well worn in its many times mended sleeves. Thank you, Mary. But it is well worn in a much, much more important way. For this is Sam Miller's doctoral gown. When he retired, he said to me, "Mark, I will have no more need for this. I'd be glad if you will." So for these 40 years, yes, Jim, I have worn Brown University's hood in honor of my teacher. Now another of my teachers, my honors program colleague, Tom Epstein, who really does hold his doctorate from Brown, will inherit this gown, and I'm glad and grateful. But in the end, my appreciation is most due to all of you, the students of Boston College. For if at Holy Cross and BC, I have learned what to love and how, it is you, the violas of Boston College, who year after year have taught me how to teach better what I love. And you've done more for me still. Once you landed in my classroom, while we were exploring together our common country, you always found new ways to teach me more. Godspeed and God bless. Good luck and goodbye. Thank you.
Arrived today from my sister, Joyce O'Connor, who also works here at Boston College. And for those of you whose Russian has gotten rusty, she says, Yoda Mihailovich Dostoevsky, and then the Brate Karamazov. So I think I might want to go that way. But you know, I have one, this is my first lesson. And I have a second one to give at the award ceremony to a graduation. And so at that award ceremony, I will use To the Lighthouse. Because it's the book I end with, and it's the book I come on to. So you can choose what you want.
Nick, Professor O'Connor, you have been an extraordinary influence on generations of students, and we cannot thank you enough for your friendship, mentorship, and guidance. And I'd like to ask you to give us hope, because we live at a time of huge international challenges, domestic challenges of strife. Your appreciation of history, why should we be hopeful? We should be, but why should we?
Because ultimately, with Camus, I believe that there is more to be hopeful about in the human condition than, again, to regret. I do. And so, for all of you who have shared a class with me, I can say that my boyish enthusiasm has only grown. And I have to say that my largest reason for hope is right here in this room. It's people like you who have made the world a better place to the extent that they could. It's people like you who come back into my life and say what you do. It's people like you who stop at my house and remind me of all the ways in which I miss you. This, it seems to me, is what makes the life of a professor so incredibly powerful. Every year I have got to see, again, as I said from the Elliott, a new beginning. And with that new beginning, I see over and over again the kind of talent, the kind of smarts, and above all, the kind of moral conviction in my students. That means that now at my age, I have many more heroes that are younger than I am than are older than me. And that's a beautiful thing. Anybody else?
What are you going to do with this country?
Well, the first thing to say is what Father Appleyard said to me. I won't embarrass him too much because I embarrassed him enough and he stepped down from being director of honors. I mean, all sorts of slurping. I quoted a poem by Elizabeth Bishop, One Arm. I just, you know, I went way over the top. And at the end of it, Joe came up to me and said, gee, Mark, I'm not dumb. In fact, I'm going in sabbatical out to Berkeley. It's not such a bad phase. So in the same sort of way, I'm not dying. I'm just retiring. And my hope is that this will open up new possibilities for me. When I stepped down from being director of honors, I did it for two reasons, and both of those reasons apply today. The first was generational generosity. I believe that somebody the age I was deserves the chance I had. And then the second reason, that weighs with me heavily, is the notion that you need professors who don't spend quite more than half of their professional life answering emails and letters from students who have graduated 10, 15, 20, 40 years ago. It's that kind of larger connection that I want to do better by. And think it's somebody else's turn to build up the kind of connection I have to you, Jake, and the kind of connection I hope we never lose. The kind of connection I look at you, Lauren, and Caleb, and Danielle, you know, Molly, I just, Margaret. You understand what I mean. If you people aren't part of my life in 10 years, if I'm still on the side of the grass, Avia, are you? Okay. It just simply won't be. The right kind of retirement. So I'm hoping not to retire completely. And I'm hoping, is this okay for me to say, Mary? Because you should all know that my much better half is here today, Mary O'Connor. Really is the one still agree that we can continue to host folks like you when you come to the house. I've mentioned to some of you, I'll tell all of you this, one of the great days in our life happened on July the 26th, 2014. And on our doorstep, all of a sudden showed up somebody from the class of 1981, Paul Morrissey. Paul and I used to run. He's now, if you need him, the leading kidney specialist in Rhode Island. A whole series of people like that from 81, 86, 88, 2010. The fellow that showed up in 2010 was Chris Eisen. Chris is at Harvard now in the law school after going through the Kennedy School with Nick. He went into harm's way in Afghanistan. Okay. He came back with a photo book from Afghanistan that he wanted to give me. And then five graduates out of the EAS class in 2014. What made that day so special for Mary and me was they sat down on the comfortable couches that so many of you have sat down in our living room. And they started to talk with one another. And the conversation that we had had in seminars over all those years continued. And it was beautiful. 81, talked to 86, we talked to 88, we talked to 2010, we talked to 2014. They just started the seminar up all over again. And all we had to do was sit in our rocking chairs and watch.
I remember last year talking to you, thinking about like dropping out, quitting myself a lot. And I wanted to ask you how you managed to instill like a will or a passion for the things that you are passionate about in other people, in like everyone in this room, just by talking to us so much.
The key issue is you know now that what we were really doing in the honors program together was not so much what the way it's conventionally known, with many of the faculty here too. That is, it's a great books, great ideas program. It is that, but it is much more a discernment program in the way I tried to describe today. So it's much more you asking, along with me, what makes this book great? And you had every right, and I know many of you exercise that right from time to time, to feel with many of the texts a distance. But the association you felt with some of those texts. Remember the paper you tried to write on Frankenstein? That's exactly what we're talking about, doesn't it? Because you were struggling to find exactly that kind of association. Anybody else? Yes, Mary. This is Mary Thomas. Class of 77? 81. You started in 77 with me.
You were there in 77
history. That's right. I was down here looking at you up there. You should know that Mary Thomas Gilligan has also given Boston College two exceptional children, Avi and Alex. And I was lucky enough to get to know them, as I did Mary. And that's another issue that is really strong, Jake, is this feeling of the transition between generations.
Aside from the students who are awesome, what would we miss most?
This. You don't get this kind of attention. Let's go for one. There's some here.
The connection between the rowing machine and your academic life?
Oh, it's a very strong connection. Mandy Spector and I share an early morning exercise routine along with Tom Gittes, who had to just leave me a minute ago. There's a whole group of us who have built a friendship around our various selected and chosen instruments of torture. And mine for years has been an orgometer, because when I was in college at Holy Cross with best friend John Bonsall, he remembers that I was on the crew team. And I developed a love of crew that has stayed with me the rest of my life. It's been absolutely essential to the kind of teaching I do around the table for a number of reasons. Number one is, by the time folks stagger in thinking that 10 o'clock is incredibly and hellishly early. I was at the gym, as you know, at 6, and I was up at 3:30 to get there. So, because for those of you who don't know, until this year, I always commuted back and forth from the Rhode Island coast. I had to get up at 3:30 to be on the road by 4 to be here at 6. This year, it became impossible, so I used that as an excuse to be able to stay with our youngest son, his wife, and the beautiful grandson and granddaughter they've given us, which makes the commute a lot easier. It's for no one. So that starts the day, and after you work out that hard, the rest of the day goes downhill. The other thing that rowing does, that's so important is it is such a cerebral sport. One wouldn't think it is because it, for those of you who have rowed, you know that you have to do exactly the same thing over and over again. Have perfect discipline and follow the back of the person in front of you. You literally have to have his or her back. But that said, the strategy of when you take a power 10, when you up your stroke, how you plot out the race has been hugely influential in the way I plot out the tempo of a seminar. Those of you who share the table with me know that at certain moments when you're flagging, I will tell you some weirdly ridiculous story. And the idea is to give you a few minutes, obviously, to catch your breath before we go on to the next. Anything else? Sorry, Justin.
Do you teach a class at UC besides the honors?
Oh, that's a very good question. Because I'm drawn in a couple of different ways. I would have loved to have gone to the Slavic department to be able to think through this lost in translation issues we're talking about. I would have loved to have talked with my close friend Andrzej Kaczynski, who represents much more the physics, if you know him well. He is about as Renaissance a man as I know. And the ability to talk with him about these things and discuss them with him in some context that we would have done together under a Slavic umbrella, it would have been a great moment. So that would be the first choice. The second choice would be going back to my history roots. There are any number of intellectual history courses that I was interested over the years and concocted in my mind, but that I never got to offer. Finally, you heard in the introduction, the Father of Apologia, that I belong to a seminar that's based out of France and Belgium, and it's interested in aesthetics and spirituality. That has always been my major intellectual umbrella, and I would have loved to offer a seminar in the connection between the two. Thank you for asking. Well, thank you for